Ayon sa kanya, tututukan nila ang pagbabakuna sa natitirang 3 milyong senior citizens at persons with comorbidities. While government is still monitoring developments in the vaccination of the 0 to 4 years old age group and awaiting approval from stringent regulatory countries. Samantala, binanggit ni Interior and Local Government Secretary Eduardo Anyo ang inilabas na memorandum circular ng kanyang departamento sa mga lokal na pamahalaan tungkol sa dispensing, selling at reselling ng mga pharmaceutical products sa mga sari-sari stores bilang pagsunod sa direktiba ng Pangulo. Kaugnay nito, sinabi naman ni Food and Drug Administration Officer in Charge, Oscar Gutierrez, na ang mga sari-sari stores ay pwede naman mag-apply bilang retail outlet for non-prescription drugs basta kanilang naisusumite ang mga kaukulang requirements. Samantala, tulad ng sinabi ko sa ating statement kahapon, naglabas ng desisyon ang Interagency Task Force or IATF kung saan binigyan ng paborableng tugon at kapasyahan ang acceptance sa national state COVID-19 vaccination certificates ng mga bansang Egypt, Maldives, Palau, Albania, Estonia, Greece, Malta at Uruguay bilang proof of vaccination for purposes of arrival quarantine protocols as well as interzonal intrazonal movement. Ang mga lugar na ito ay dagdag sa nauna ng mga bansa, teritoryo, jurisdiction kung saan ang proof of vaccination ay aprobado na ng IATF. Inatasan ng IATF ang Bureau of Quarantine, ang Department of Transportation One-Stop Shop at ang Bureau of Immigration na kilalanin ang lahat ng proofs of vaccination na aking nabanggit. Umaabot na po sa 64 na bansa, teritoryo, jurisdictions ang ating kinikilala at tinatanggap ang kanilang proof of vaccination. Isa-isahin po natin, Armenia, Australia, Austria, Bahrain, Belgium, Canada, Colombia, Czech Republic, France, Georgia, Germany, Hong Kong, SAR, India, Iraq, Italy, Japan, Kazakhstan, Kuwait, Monaco, New Zealand, Oman, Qatar, Samoa, Singapore, Slovenia, Sri Lanka, Switzerland, Thailand, the Netherlands, Tunisia, Turkey, United Arab Emirates, United Kingdom, United States of America, Vietnam, Brazil, Israel, Timor-Leste, Republic of Korea, Malaysia, Republic of Ireland, Argentina, Brunei Darussalam, Cambodia, Chile, Denmark, Ecuador, Indonesia, Myanmar, Papua New Guinea, Peru, Portugal, Spain, Azerbaijan, Macau, SAR, Syria, Egypt, Maldives, Palau, Albania, Estonia, Greece, Malta, at Uruguay. Sa usaping bakuna, dumating kagabi, February 21, 2022, ang karagdagang 293,670 doses ng Pfizer vaccine na donasyon ng Australian government sa pamamagitan ng UNICEF. Thank you, Australia, for your generosity. Samantala, meron na po tayong 134,332,014 na total doses administered as of February 21, 2022. Nasa mahigit 61.8 million na ang naka-first dose, habang nasa mahigit 62.6 million ang naka-complete dose or fully vaccinated, kasama na rito ang nabakunahan ng Janssen. Ayon sa National COVID-19 Vaccination Dashboard, nasa mahigit 9.7 million naman ang nakatanggap ng booster or additional doses. Pumunta naman po tayo sa COVID-19 update. Patuloy ang pagbaba ng mga bagong kaso. Ayon sa February 21, 2022 COVID-19 case bulletin ng Department of Health, nasa 1,427 ang mga bagong kaso ng COVID sa bansa. Ito na ang pinakamababang naitala ngayong taon. Sa bilang na ito, 92.2% ang mild at asymptomatic. Samantala, ang positivity rate ay patuloy na bumababa na nasa 7.5% na lamang. Pinakamababa mula noong December 28, 2021. Malapit na tayo sa 5%, habang nasa 96.9% naman ang porsyento ng mga gumaling. Mayigit 3.5 million naman po ang nakarecover at gumaling mula sa karamdamang ito. Amin naman pong malungkot na binabalita na kahapon ay mayroong 79 na pumanaw dahil sa virus na ito. Our fatality rate is currently at 1.53%. This is lower than the 2% global average. Sa estado naman ng ating mga ospital, nasa below 30% na ang ating hospital care utilization rate. Now we have some welcome news for the tourism sector. Nasa 24,826 ang ating inbound arrivals sa iba't ibang paliparan sa bansa. Ayon sa datos ng One Health Pass, sa bilang na ito, nasa 13,492 ay mga banyaga, habang nasa 11,334 ay mga balikbayan. Naka-flash po sa inyong mga screen ang mga bansang may pinakamalaking bilang na mga bumisita sa Pilipinas mula nang tayo ay nagbukas noong February 10. Ang mga datos na ito ay as of February 20, 2022. Please take note that this is just the beginning of our efforts to encourage tourists to visit the country. Bukas na po ang ating mga borders, pero paalala lang po na napakalaga po ng pagbabakuna para mabuhay ang turismo ng bansa. If we want a surge of tourists instead of a surge of COVID cases, then we enjoin everyone to get vaccinated and to get their booster shots. Tulungan po natin ang ating mga kababayan na nagtatrabaho sa mga tourism-related industries. Still on other matters, London-based IHS Marquette says the Philippines is set to join the ranks of a small group of countries in the Asia-Pacific region that will have a GDP exceeding $1 trillion by 2033. This is certainly welcome news. If you would recall, our economic team remains optimistic that the COVID-19 pandemic will not derail the Philippine vision to eliminate poverty by 2040. Malungkot na balita, mga kababayan. We express our deepest condolences to the family, friends, and colleagues of Tarlac 1st District Representative Carlos Charlie Cuanco, who passed away at the age of 58. We join his loved ones in praying for his eternal repose. Bago tayo pumunta sa mga tanong ng MPC, mga kasama natin si DOH Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere para magbigay ulat sa national situation. USEC Rosette, ano po ang ibig sabihin ng adverse events following immunization at ano po ang karaniwang reaksyon matapos magpabakuna? Dapat bang matakot ang ating mga kababayan dito?
Thank you, CabSec. Magandang hapon po, Cabinet Secretary Nograles. And of course, good afternoon to Consul General Rally Tejada. So ngayong araw po, magbibigay lang kami ng kaunting impormasyon ukol po sa COVID-19 status ng ating bansa at tungkol sa adverse events following immunization. So next slide, please. Next slide. Magandang balita po ang bungad namin sa inyo. Sa kasalukuyan, nasa low-risk case classification na tayo at nananatili pong negative ang ating one-week at two-week growth rates, habang moderate risk naman po ang ating average daily attack rate or ADAR. Lahat din po ng ating island groups, Luzon, Visayas at Mindanao, ay nagpapakita na ng unti-unting pagbaba ng mga kaso. sa lahat po ng rehiyon, mas mababa na po sa 1,000 ang mga naitatalang kaso kada araw para sa linggong ito. Maliban sa CAR at Region 11, ang lahat po ng rehiyon ay nasa low-risk case classification na. Gayunpaman, lahat po ng rehiyon ay nagpapakita na ng negative 2-week growth rates na nakakakita na po tayo ng pagbaba ng bilang ng mga bagong kaso ng COVID-19. Ang atin din pong National Healthcare Systems Capacity ay nasa low risk maliban lang po sa Region 11 na nasa moderate risk ang kanilang ICU utilization rate na kasalukuyan po ay nasa 58%. Next slide. Noong panahon po ng Alpha at Beta, nagsimulang tumaas ang mga kaso sa huling linggo ng February of 2021. Mula po sa average na 1,797 daily cases noong February 16 to 22, inabot na po sa halos 7 para umabot sa peak noong April 15 kung saan nagkaroon po tayo ng 10,825 average daily cases. Pagkatapos po ng 7 na obserbahan muli natin ang pagbaba ng mga kaso. Pagsapit po naman ng Hulyo, muling nakita ang pagtaas ng mga kaso dahil naman sa Delta variant. Mula sa 5,573 average daily cases noong July 21 to 27, umabot po tayo sa 20,903 average daily cases noong September 12. Pagkalipas ng halos 7 o 42 days. Inabot ng 15 weeks or 108 days bago naman po natin nakita ang pagbaba ng mga kaso pagkatapos nating maabot ang peak, mas matagal ito kumpara sa alpha at beta variants. Nadetect ang Omicron sa ating bansa noong Oktubre. Dito po natin nakita ang biglaang pag-angat muli ng mga kaso. Mula sa 629 cases kada araw noong December 25 to 30, dumami po ito by 180% at umabot sa 34,903 cases kada araw noong January 18. Ito ay nag-peak sa loob lamang ng 3 o 19 days. Bagamat ito ang pinakamabilis at pinakamalaking pag-angat ng kaso na ating nakita, ito rin po ang pinakamabilis na bumaba. Inabot lamang tayo ng 3 or 22 days upang makita muli ang pagbaba ng mga kaso mula sa peak. Bagamat pinakamaraming kaso ang naitala sa Omicron period, ang Omicron variant din ang may pinakitang kakaunting severe at critical cases. Karamihan ng severe at critical cases ay nakita noong Delta situation ng ating bansa. Next slide. Kasabay ng patuloy na pagbaba ng mga kaso ng COVID-19, ang pagbaba ng bilang ng ating severe and critical cases na nauospital ay bumababa na rin. Batay sa aming latest data, 12-15% na lamang ng national hospital admissions ang malubha at critical. Karamihan sa mga nauospital ay mild at moderate ang simptomas. Patotoo ito na mabisang panangga ang mga bakuna laban sa malubha at critical na sakit na dulot ng COVID-19. Kaya po muli nais pong ipaalala ng Kagawaran ng Kalusugan na hikayatin po natin ang ating mga mahal sa buhay, ating mga kaibigan at ang ating mga kakilala na magpabakuna na sa lalong madaling panahon para sa karagdagang proteksyon laban sa virus. Next slide. Dumako naman po tayo sa usaping adverse events following immunization or what we call AEFI. Ano po nga ba ang AEFI? Ang AEFI, ang adverse events following immunization, ay anumang pangyayari matapos ang pagbabakuna. Ang AEFI ay mga simptomas o resulta ng laboratory test o sakit na maaring mangyari o maramdaman matapos ang pagbabakuna. Gayunpaman, nais pong linawi ng DOH na hindi po sa lahat ng pagkakataon ay AEFI ang maaring nararanasan ng isang individual matapos mabakunahan. Maari ang mga nararanasang AEFI ay hindi po dahil sa bakuna. Kagaya halimbawa kung nakaranas po ng pagsusuka ang isang individual matapos siyang mabakunahan, ngunit pagkatapos naman ay napatunayan na ito pala ay food poisoning. Maaring matukoy na AEFI ang nausea, ngunit ito ay hindi dahil sa bakuna. Bagamat matutukoy na hindi karaniwang pangyayari, kung sakasakali ang isang individual ay mamamatay pagkatapos mabakunahan, sa kadahilanan ng ito ay maaring nabangga ng sasakyan habang tumatawid, Maituturing pa rin po itong AEFI or adverse event following immunization, ngunit hindi po ito dahil sa bakuna. Next slide. Narito naman po ang ilang mga karaniwang reaksyon or AEFI na maaari niyong maramdaman pagkatapos kayo ay mabakunahan. Una at madalas ay ang pananakit, pamumula, pangangati o yung pamamaga doon po sa injection site. Pangalawa, yung pagkapagod o parang fatigue. Pangatlo ay ang pananakit ng kasukasuan or joints or your muscles. Maari rin pong makaranas ng pagbigat ng pakiramdam. Maari rin pong lagnatin o makaranas ng panginginig or chills. At panghuli sa ating mga halimbawa ay ang pagkakaroon ng sakit ng ulo or headache. Ang mga nabanggit na reaksyon ay mga karaniwang sinyales ng immune response ng katawan sa bakuna. Ang mga reaksyong ito ay agaran at kusang nawawala rin sa loob ng 1 hanggang 3 araw. Kung may nararamdaman po kahit na anumang simptomas matapos kayo ay mabakunahan, agad nyo po itong i-report doon po sa inyong vaccination site. Next slide. Nais pong linawin ng kagawaran ng kalusugan ang pagkakaiba ng non-serious adverse event following immunization mula sa serious adverse event following immunization. Ang non-serious AEFI ay kagaya ng mga nabanggit sa naunang slide. Ito ay ang mga karaniwang nararamdaman matapos mabakunahan at agarin ding nawawala matapos ang ilang araw at maaring gamutin sa inyong mga sariling tahanan. Sa kabilang banda, ang mga serious AEFI ay ang mga AEFI na maaring makapagresulta sa pagkamatay, hospitalization, pagpapatagal sa kasalukuyang pagkakaospital o ang pagkakaroon ng significant disability or incapacity. Nais bigyang diin ng kagawaran na ang serious AEFI ay very rare o napakadalang pong mangyari. Nasa 30 out of 1 million doses na naiturok ang bilang ng mga kaso ng serious AEFIs dito sa ating bansa na ating naitala. Next slide. So bakit kailangan tuloy-tuloy po ba ang pagmamonitor natin sa ating mga adverse events following immunization? Kailangan po itong matukoy at masuri ang relasyon nitong adverse event na ito sa pagbabakuna. Kailangan natin malaman kung ang mga ilang importanteng medical events o tinatawag na adverse events of special interest ay higit na dumadami habang tayo po ay nagbabakuna. Ilang halimbawa nito ay ang sinasabi nating myocarditis at pericarditis. Makakatulong din po ang mga datos na nakalap upang mabigyan ng ebidensya na higit ang kaligtasan at proteksyon na naibibigay kumpara sa mga posibleng negatibong epekto matapos ang pagbabakuna. Sa madaling salita, the benefits that our vaccine may provide greatly outweigh the risks. Next slide. Nais din po naming bigyang diin mula sa kagawaran ng kalusugan na less than 30 per 1 million doses had serious AEFI cases here in the country. Ipinapakita po sa slide na ito sa tala ng ating Epidemiology Bureau, ang bilang ng mga nagtala ng serious AEFI ay higit 4,000 kaso o katumbas na ng nasa 30 sa bawat 1,000,000 doses ng bakuna laban sa COVID-19. Mayroon din pong naitala na higit 1,600 na pagkakamatay matapos ang kanilang pagbabakuna o 12 kada 1 million doses. Tandaan po natin na ang deaths na ito ay hindi rin po kaagad nangangahulugan na ito ay sanhi o dahil sa bakuna. Kinakailangan at nagsasagawa pa po tayo ng tinatawag nating causality assessment upang matukoy kung talagang ang mga bakuna ba ang sanhi ng mga naitalang AEFI. Muling bilang halimbawa ng adverse event following immunization, kung ang isang individual ay mamamatay matapos mabakunahan sa kadahilanan ng freak accident, kagaya ng nabangga ng sasakyan, nahulog sa rilis ng tren, nabagsakan ng mabigat na bagay mula sa mataas na gusali at iba pa, maari po itong maitukoy or maklasify na AEFI. Ngunit, again, muli po naming ine-emphasize, hindi po ito dahil sa ating mga bakuna. Next slide. Sa slide na ito naman, tatalakayin natin ang proseso po natin ng AEFI surveillance. Ang ating unang proseso ng AEFI surveillance ay binubuo ng pagtukoy sa mga adverse events following immunization galing sa ating mga healthcare professionals sa vaccination site, sa mga ospital, o di kaya sa ating mga rural health units. Maari rin din ang pagtukoy ng AEFI ay mula po sa sariling pagbabantay ng simptomas na pwedeng maramdaman matapos mabakunahan ng ating mga kababayan. Kinakailangan din pong i-report sa mga kinakaukulan ang mga adverse events na mararamdaman o mararanasan. Agaran niyo pong abisuhan ang inyong healthcare workers sa vaccination site o di kaya sa mga ospital at local health offices. Maari rin po kayo mag-report ng AEFI ang ating mga pharmaceutical companies na tinatawag nilang market authorization holders. Kasama po yan sa kanilang mga obligasyon nung tayo po ay nagkaroon ng commitment na makabili ng bakuna sa kanila. Kung makakaramdam ng hindi magandang simptomas, lalo na kung sa tingin nyo ay maari po itong lumala, agaran po tayo mag-report sa ating mga disease surveillance units sa inyong mga local epidemiology and surveillance units. Dapat tayo ay laging maging tapat sa mga inire-report po natin upang ang mga sumusunod na proseso sa AEFI investigation ay mas mapadali. During the AEFI investigation, kinakalap ang lahat ng mga medical records, ini-interview po ang mga kamag-anak, pati na rin po ang mga doktor at health professionals na naging bahagi ng kasong ni-report. Dagdag pa rito ay ang pag-iimbestiga sa vaccination site kung paano itinago ang mga bakuna at pamamaraan ng pagturok sa ating vaccine recipients. Ibig sabihin, tinitigan din po natin ang proseso ng ating pagbabakuna mismo sa vaccination site. Kapag nakalap na po natin ang sapat na impormasyon, ito po ay pinag-aaralan ng ating mga eksperto sa ating Regional Adverse Events Following Immunization Committee or REFIC at ang ating National Adverse Events Following Immunization Committee or NAFIC. Sa pagtatapos ng kanilang assessment ay nagkakaroon ng maayos na feedback sa ating mga local governments tungkol sa naging assessment ng ating mga eksperto. Naiintindihan namin na maaring hindi ito katanggap-tanggap sa ating mga kababayan, ngunit nais pong ipabatid ng DOH na masusi po itong pinag-aralan ng ating mga eksperto. Next slide. Makakaasa rin po ang publiko ng Food and Drug Administration at ang DOH Epidemiology Bureau ay magkasamang nagtataguyod upang masigurong ang lahat ng AEFI ay properly monitored. Nais din pong linawin ng DOH na ang FDA ang naatasang mamuno ng vaccine safety surveillance sa ating bansa. Kung kaya't inyong nakikita sa kanilang website ang mga report tungkol sa mga AEFI ng bakuna laban sa COVID-19. Ang DOH ang umaagapay sa Food and Drug Administration sa paniniguradong ang mga nai-report sa FDA, lalo na po yung mga serious AEFI, ay nabe-verify at kailangan ng masusing investigasyon. Maaring ang aming maipapakitang datos ay naiiba minsan sa inilalabas na report ng FDA, lalo na sa mga bilang ng serious adverse events following immunization. Bakit po ba ito nangyayari? Ang VigiFlow na reporting system ng FDA ang kumakalap ng lahat ng reports mula po sa ating mga ospital, sa ating mga vaccination sites, from disease surveillance officers, at maging mula sa ating publiko. Samantalang ang DOH naman po ay nangangailangan pa ng case investigation form at dagdag patunay na ang mga serious adverse events following immunization na nai-report ay na-validate na ng mga epidemiology and surveillance units. Ang dagdag na verifikasyon at investigasyon ay mahalaga sa pagsasagawa ng causality assessment ng ating mga eksperto. Dahil po ganito ang nagaganap sa ating kasalukuyang sistema, ito po ay nagdaragdag ng oras sa pagsasagawa ng investigasyon at pagkalap ng kinakailangang impormasyon. Sinisigurado po ng DOH na ang pag-verify ay ginagawa sa bawat serious adverse event following immunization na inire-report kung kaya't hindi maiiwasang hindi magtugma minsan ang aming mga numero. Next slide. Mas marami po ang namamatay dahil sa COVID-19. Kung ikukumpara natin sa ating mga bakuna, kaya mahalaga mabakunahan po tayong lahat. Ang bilang po ng mga namatay dahil sa COVID-19 sa ating bansa ay nasa higit na 15,000 sa bawat 1 milyong Pilipino. Kung ito naman ay ikukumpara sa mga assessment ng ating eksperto sa mga AEFI deaths, nasa 3 deaths lamang kada isang 100 million doses ng bakuna ang may sapat na ebidensya upang masabi na ang bakuna ay sanhi ng pagkakamatay ng mga individual na ito. Makikita natin na sa napakalaki ng pagkakaiba ng mga rates na ito at patunay sa napakalaking benepisyo na nakukuha natin sa bakuna from prevention of having severe disease or in this case, becoming a fatality due to COVID-19. Kaya naman po, muli hinihikayat po ng kagawaran ang bawat isa na magpabakuna na dahil mas mabisang proteksyon pa rin laban sa pagkakaospital at pagkakamatay ang pagiging bakunado. Next slide. At para naman po sa ating pahuling paalala, batid po ng kagawaran ng kalusugan at ng Food and Drug Administration na ang mga adverse event following immunization ay aming pong iminimonitor upang masigurado na mas higit pa rin ang benepisyong ating makukuha sa pagbabakuna kaysa sa risk at serious AEFIs na maari po nating maranasan. Hindi lamang po ang DOH ang nag-aaral at nag-iimbestiga ng mga naitatalang adverse event following immunization, kung hindi pati na rin po ang napakarami pa nating eksperto sa ating bansa. Patuloy po ang pag-aaral sa ating mga AEFIs upang matukoy ang mga serious adverse event following immunization na maaring nakuha mula sa bakuna laban sa COVID-19. Panghuli, batid po ng kagawaran ng kalusugan na ayon sa ating mga datos, ang atin pong mga bakuna ay maituturing pa rin ligtas at totoong epektibo laban sa malubha at critical na sakit na buhat ng virus. Kaya naman, magpabakuna na po tayong lahat at kung tayo po ay eligible na, let us all receive our booster doses. Maraming salamat po and over to you, Kabsek.
Maraming salamat, Yusek Rosette. Please stay on board for questions from the media. Makakasama rin po natin si Philippine Consul General to Hong Kong, Rally Tejada. Pinapakumusta po ng ating Pangulo ang kalagayan ng ating mga kababayan dyan sa Hong Kong. Pakibigyan niyo po kami ng update. Ilan na po sa ating mga kababayan dyan sa Hong Kong ang tinamaan po ng COVID-19? Consul General?
Magandang hapon po, Secretary Nograles at Yusek Barriere. Good afternoon po sa inyong lahat. The Philippine Consulate in Hong Kong wishes to assure the public that all Filipinos needing emergency assistance due to the recent surge of COVID-19 cases in Hong Kong have been accounted for and assisted. In the current fifth wave that Hong Kong is now experiencing, 61 Filipinos have tested positive, with around 31 who approached the consulate for assistance, either for hospital admission or access to isolation rooms. Through the immediate intervention of the consulate and in collaboration with the Hong Kong authorities, our NGO friends, and the Filipino community, I am pleased to report that all of them are safe and have received medical attention and are now staying in an isolation facility. It must be noted that the severity and magnitude of the fifth wave in Hong Kong took everyone by surprise and affected not just Filipinos but all citizens. It has put a tremendous strain on Hong Kong's health system, prompting Hong Kong to take special measures in order to effectively respond to the current challenge, one of which is to provide an extra 20,000 capacity isolation facility, among others, to cater to those immediately needing isolation rooms. I'm glad to report that just a few minutes ago, upon our representations, the Hong Kong government through the Labor Department assured the consulate that all Filipinos in Hong Kong, most especially, of course, our hardworking foreign domestic helpers that are needing medical attention and isolation, will be treated and taken to an isolation facility if necessary. The consulate has also published a comprehensive yet easy to follow advisory to guide the Filipino community regarding the current health protocols in Hong Kong that everyone must follow if one tests positive for COVID-19. The Philippine government through the consulate continues to work hard to assist all Filipinos in Hong Kong. Thus, we urge all Filipinos in Hong Kong to take utmost care stay in a safe environment and follow all social distancing measures and other regulations by the Hong Kong government. Also, please get vaccinated, mga kababayan. Finally, we wish to assure the Filipino community in Hong Kong that we are ready to respond to all your concerns or requests for assistance. All you need to do is just call our 24/7 hotline, which is 9155-4023. May I repeat, that is 9155-4023, and we are ready to help. Thank you very much, Secretary Nograles.
Maraming salamat, Conjen. Please also stay on board for questions from the media. And with that, tumungo naman po tayo kay Yusek Rocky na nandito sa tabi ko para sa mga katanungan mula sa MPC.
Thank you, Sec Carlo. Good afternoon po sa ating mga bisita. At syempre sa Malacanang Press Corps na namimiss na rin ang press briefing room. Ang una pong tanong ay mula kay MJ Blanca Flor ng Daily Tribune. Palace comment daw, Secretary. President Biden said he was convinced that Russian President Vladimir Putin has decided to launch a further invasion in Ukraine and that he has a reason to believe it will occur in the coming days.
Well, unang-una sa lahat, syempre we hope that all parties will explore all avenues for peace. Sana po ay makapaghanap po tayo lahat, no, dito sa buong mundo, makapaghanap po ng mabuting avenues para matagumpay nating marating ang kapayapaan. That being said, your government and our President, Rodrigo Roa Duterte, has been preparing for any and all eventualities and all contingencies ay pinaghahandaan na po ng inyong pamahalaan.
Opo. Second question mula po kay Ace Romero ng Philippine Star for Yusek Berhere. Yusek Berhere, Health Secretary Duque cited an additional condition for an area to be placed under alert level 1. At least 80% of seniors and people with health risk should be vaccinated. Why adopt this additional condition? Is Metro Manila qualified based on this new metric? Similar question po yan with Ivan Mayrina ng GMA, Caroline Bongkin ng CNN Philippines.
Yes, Mr. Krakino. So unang-una po, this is not an additional condition. If you remember, there was this IATF resolution, I think dated November or December last year, kung saan ipatupad natin yung alert level system. At kasama po doon sa metrics ng alert level 1, ito pong vaccination coverage. At least 70% ng eligible population ay bakunado. Tapos kasama po yung ating clause for senior citizens dyan. So this is not an additional condition. What was changed was the target number, no? So dati po, ang atin pong nire-require lang was just 70% for senior citizens. Ngayon, tinaasan na po to 80% kasi mataas na po ang bakunahan natin at marami na po tayong bakuna sa ngayon. So hindi na po natin kailangan magkaroon ng rason kung bakit mababa pa rin pagdating sa ating mga nakakatanda at sa ating mga persons with comorbidities. The very reason why we are having this kind of target, no, increased target for senior citizens and those with comorbidities, dahil alam po natin sila po yung pinaka-vulnerable pagdating sa COVID-19. At gusto natin pag tayo ay nag-de-escalate to alert level 1, yung new normal natin, protektado po itong mga vulnerable population natin para additional safeguard natin yan para hindi po ma-overwhelm ang ating healthcare system if ever po na magkakaroon ulit tayo ng pagtaas ng kaso.
Thank you, Yusek Berhere. Sunod na tanong mula kay Ace Romero ng Philippine Star, Sec Carlo, will the IATF set more conditions for alert level 1?
Ayan po ipag-uusapan sa IATF meeting natin. No, sa Thursday, may IATF meeting tayo, may ire-report po sa amin, sa IATF, at pagdidesisyonan po ng IATF kung ano yung magiging final na requirements natin for any area in the Philippines to be placed under alert level 1. And any announcement for alert level 1 and for the other alert levels will be done before March 1, syempre. So, yung new alert level systems po natin will be for the period March 1 to March 15. And we will make the announcement before March 1.
Thank you, Sir Carlo.
Okay. Tumungo naman po tayo kay Trish Terada ng CNN.
Hi, good afternoon, Secretary Karlo. Sir, just on Dr. Nati Castro's arrest, several groups have raised their concern over the arrest of Dr. Natividad Castro, and initial accounts point to be that she's being a victim of red tagging. And yung mga groups na to, sir, they are reputable groups calling for the immediate end of harassment and intimidation tactics na ginagamit daw po kay Dr. Nati. What does the president know about this, and will he intervene considering that these are reputable groups calling for action amid the seeming irregularities arrest ni Dr. Nat?
Well, we'll refer you to the statement of the ILG Secretary Anyo, no, and the facts of the case. Una sa lahat, hindi po yun dahil sa quote-unquote sinasabing red tagging. If you look at the facts of the case, the arrest was made by virtue of an arrest warrant issued by a regional trial court for serious illegal detention and kidnapping. So may specific crime po that was the cause of the warrant of arrest issued by the RTC court.
Mm-hmm. But sir, still, even if there is an actual case, some can't help that these could just be trumped up charges, you know, to formally make a case against her. And hindi marami din po ngayon tuloy nagtatanong kumbaga or nagli-link nito sa implementation ng anti-terror law, although it's a different case. I understand it's not related to anti-terror law, but doesn't this call for a review of how the law enforcement units implement the law in general, not just the anti-terror law? Can they just red tag anyone who's a human rights advocate, even if they insist on saying that this is not a case of red tag?
Again, no, hindi siya case ng red tagging. The arrest warrant was issued by the court. But even previous to that, dumaan po ito ng proseso ng investigation ng prosecutor. And at every avenue and at every opportunity, nabigyan po ang mga abogado ng pagkakataon. They had all opportunities to contest it from the point na nag-preliminary investigation. If they did not agree with the findings ng prosecutor, they also had legal remedies after that, hanggang dumating na nga sa korte at final at sinampa sa korte. And now, now that the warrant of arrest as issued by the RTC court was served, it will now take the judicial process and may legal remedies din po doon. So we understand, as stated by Secretary Anyo, that maraming abogado ang nagre-represent kay Doc Nati. At they would, as lawyers, should know all of the legal remedies available to them.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir, maraming lawyers. But yun nga po, sir, paano kung halimbawa mangyari ito sa isang individual who doesn't have as much support from the lawyers or who doesn't have as much connection, sir? Ang tanong po kasi ngayon dito, yung irregularities of the arrest. When she was arrested, for a while she's gone incommunicado, and the lawyers are actually demanding for still some documents, still some explanation bakit for a time hindi sila magkaroon ng access to Dr. Nati.
All,
doesn't that merit an investigation?
All law enforcement authorities and all legal authorities maintain that the proper procedure was followed. And if the lawyer of Dr. Nati would like to question that, they have legal remedies available to them and their client. But the legal authorities, law enforcement authorities, and all authorities for that matter involved in the case maintain that all legal protocols and procedures were followed.
Mm-hmm. Sir, on another topic, yung sa COMELEC commissioners na lang po, ilang weeks na rin po since nag-retire po yung ating tatlong commissioners. Hanggang ngayon po, wala pa rin po bang napipili si Pangulo na COMELEC commissioners? And can we at least have any information tungkol po dun sa shortlist ng Pangulo with regard to the COMELEC commissioners?
Well, the president is mindful of the deadlines, no, the legal and lawful deadlines for the appointment of these very important appointees to the COMELEC. So knowing the deadline and knowing that there's a vetting process at kailangan dumaan din po sa vetting process, ay hintayin na lang po natin. No, rest assured that the President will make the appointments soon, beating the deadline and making sure that it will not fall within the deadline. So, antayin na lang po natin.
How soon, sir, this week?
Abangan na lang po natin kasi even I cannot give a definite timeline or answer as to a particular date and time.
All right. Thank you very much, Secretary Karlo.
Thank you, Trish. Back to you, Yusek Rocky.
Yes, thank you, Sec Carlo. Ibigay ko na lang po muna itong follow-up question ni Ace Romero ng Philippine Star. Additional query lang daw po, yung NCR po ba daw ay qualified doon sa 80% target para mailagay sa Alert Level 1? And nabanggit nyo po kanina daw na yung areas na pinag-aaralan pwede ilagay sa Alert Level 1. Ano daw po yung mga areas na yon?
We will wait, no. Like I said, yung procedure kasi namin sa IATF is before we announce any alert level for a particular period, we want to study the numbers as closely to the period as possible. So halimbawa, sabihin natin March 1. March 1 po yun, ano? 2:15 ang next announcement po natin. Of course, magkakaroon tayo ng IATF meeting sa Thursday. But may ilang araw pa bago mag-March 1 over the weekend, di ba? May Feb 25, 26, 27. So pag-usapan pa namin sa IATF on how long we will wait, maybe perhaps during the weekend pa talaga namin ma-announce ang ating alert level system for March 1. Although on Thursday, meron na kaming indicative na alert level classification sa lahat ng mga areas, whether alert level 2 ba yan, or meron ba mag-alert level 1, or meron pa ba maiwan na alert level 3, halimbawa, no? But tingnan natin, no? As close to March 1 as possible, that's when we will definitely make the decision.
Apo. Sunod na magtatanong si Ivan Mayrina ng GMA News. What does the President have to say about yesterday's tragic crash of a PNP chopper en route to Balesin to pick up the chief PNP from his vacation? Does the policy anything irregular over the use of the organization's air assets for the chief PNP's personal trip? Similar question po yan with Lanes Capanti ng GMA News Online.
Una sa lahat, kami po ay nakikiramay sa pamilya ng isang crew member na namatay dahil sa crash na ito. At we wish the two injured a speedy recovery. Pangalawa po, DILG or the Department of the Interior and Local Government is currently investigating the circumstances surrounding the fatal crash of the chopper. So abangan na lang po natin kung ano yung magiging resulta ng investigasyon na yan ng DILG.
Follow-up question po ni Lanes Capanti ng GMA News. May pananagutan po ba dito ang PNP chief?
We will await the report of the DILG. It is currently being investigated.
From Joel Paleño ng DWIC, halos malapit na pumalo daw po sa 100 pesos ang kada litro ng mga produktong petrolyo. Sa tingin nyo, dapat na po ba kabilang din sa magiging priority program ng susunod na Pangulo ng Bansa ang pagbasura sa oil deregulation law na isa rin sa labis na nagpapahirap sa mga Pilipino, hindi lamang sa mga driver ng pampublikong transportasyon?
Well, I cannot speak for in behalf of the next president or the incoming president. So, pasensya po. With regard to any amendments, if any, of any laws that will have to pass through Congress.
From Rose Novenario of Hataw, may connection po kaya ang pag-aresto kay Doc Nati Castro sa inilabas na EU Parliament Resolution on February 17, 2022 regarding daw po sa possible removal of trade perks sa Philippine due to EJ case, HR violation, etc. Considering na isa si Doc Nati sa mga naglatag dati ng kalagayan ng lumad community sa UN at sa EU Council.
That is pure speculation.
Follow up po ni Rose Novenario, ano po ang reaksyon ng palaso sa pahayag ng Health at Human Rights Organization na, I quote, there is a menacing pattern of red tagging, arrest, and killing of doctors and health workers in the country, end quote. Mapipigilan ba ng palaso ang mga insidenteng ito at matitiyak na makakamit ng pamilya ng mga biktima ang hustisya?
Again, wala pong red tagging na nagaganap. Pangalawa po, any and all crimes, ininvestigahan po yan ng lahat ng mga kinaukulan, our law enforcement authorities. And if you would notice yung report po ni Secretary Anyo kay Pangulo kagabi, index crimes po natin ay bumababa. Simula nung nanungkulan si Pangulong Rodrigo Roa Duterte, simula nung siya ay naging pangulo, hanggang ngayon po ay pababa ng pababa po ang index crimes po natin. And even overall crimes, non-index and index crimes are all going down. And our law enforcement agencies continue to work hard para mas lalong mapababa ang krimen dito sa ating bansa. Kasama na dyan yung murders, homicide, and other serious crimes.
From Laila Salaveria na Inquirer for Consul General Tejada, although may nasagot na po kayo kanina tungkol dito, basahin ko na lang po yung tanong, baka may dagdag po kayo. What kind of commitment, if any, has the Hong Kong government made regarding the fate of OFWs who test positive for COVID?
Kaya po nang nasabi ko, nagpahayag po ang Hong Kong government, kani-kanina lamang po, they reassured us of their support. Lahat po na magkakasakit na Pilipino dito sa Hong Kong ay pagagamot po nila at bibigyan ng isolation facility. So yan po ay galing mismo sa government ng Hong Kong, kanilang representative from the Labor Department. So noon pa man eh, ganito naman din ang ginagawa ng Hong Kong. Ano? Lahat po na nagkakasakit na Pilipino talaga po, hindi naman na tayo nila binibigo. Lahat sila ay pinagagamot muna nila. At talaga naman pong hanggang gumaling at makalabas ng ospital, assisted po nila. So they've continued doing that and we are confident that they will continue doing so.
Apo. Congen, follow-up question po. Has the consulate received reports of OFWs being prohibited to leave their employers' homes and taking their day off because of fears they could be infected? If yes, what is being done about this?
Well, of course, sa community po dito sa Hong Kong, usap-usapan po nga yung kung lalabas ka o hindi, sapagkat sa dami nga po ng nagkaka-virus sa labas, at talaga na pong napakataas ng surge ng Omicron variant dito po ngayon sa Hong Kong. Ngunit talagi po namin pinaalala po sa ating community na mag-ingat po and stay in a safe environment. Ngunit ayon po sa patas ng Hong Kong kasi, ang isang manggagawa ay allowed to have one day off every week. So yun po ay kanilang dapat i-exercise if they want to. But if they're going to exercise their rest day, make sure that they are staying in a safe environment and exercising atmosphere. But katulad nga po ng ating pakiusap sa kanila, times are different now. It's really, really dangerous to go out sapagkat ang ating sitwasyon ay delikado, patuloy ang pag-record ng mataas na numbers of COVID infections. So nakikiusap kami sa ating mga kababayan to remain safe. Remain safe and stay in a safe environment. At kung maaari po ay isalang-alang ang lahat ng social distancing measures at regulation ng Hong Kong government upang magapi na po natin itong Omicron variant na kasalukuyang nananalasa po dito sa Hong Kong.
Thank you, Consul General. Sir Karlo, kay Laila Salaveria pa rin po na inquirer, you said the admin has taken steps to address raised by the European Parliament about the human rights situation in the country, but then how does Malacanang explain the reported manner of arrest of Dr. Natividad Castro, who was denied access to a lawyer? The police also reportedly did not properly identify themselves and refused to tell her family where she was taken. What does the palace think of this?
Well, again, we were assured by DILG Secretary that our legal authorities, our law enforcement authorities, did everything by the book. They maintained that proper procedures and protocols were followed. And again, as stated by Secretary Ed Anyo, the cases are now with court. We must allow the judicial process to proceed and take its rightful course. The accused shall be entitled to every legal remedy available in her defense, and she already has a battery of top-notch lawyers.
From Joseph Morong ng GMA News for Sec Karlo and Conjan Tejada, with the surge of cases in Hong Kong, is there a necessity to impose a travel ban for Hong Kong?
No decision on that matter yet as of the moment. We just must ensure that lahat ng ating mga kababayang OFW na pupunta sa ibang lugar, kailangan fully vaccinated po. Yan po pinakamabisang paraan para ma-assure natin yung kanilang full protection pag sila po'y pumunta ng ibang bansa. Conjen?
Salamat po, Secretary. Sugat po lamang po ang inyong sinabi. Tama po yan, magpapaksinate po tayo sapagkat yun lamang po ang scientific way of really getting out of this pandemic that we are currently experiencing. Kung maaari po sana, huwag po sana mag-ban ng pagpapauwi ng ating mga Pilipinas sa Pilipinas sapagkat marami pa rin pong mga kababayan natin ang patuloy na umuwi galing Hong Kong papuntang Pilipinas. But of course, that is a decision that I leave to our experts and our superiors in Manila. But of course, due to the also visa restrictions, hindi rin po makapunta rito ang mga Filipino. At these things are things that need to be assessed and discussed by our superiors in Manila. But patuloy pa rin pa kasi po ang pag-uwi ng ating mga kababayan sa Pilipinas. As we speak, meron po pa rin mga flights na pumupuntang Pilipinas. Ngunit ang ban po ngayon ay yung Hong Kong papuntang Pilipinas papuntang Hong Kong. So, recapping, nasa Pilipinas na po ang desisyon kung sa ganyang katanungan.
I-clarify ko lang, Yusek Rocky, no? Tayo ang policy talaga natin sa bansang Pilipinas. Lahat ng Pilipinong gustong umuwi ay papayagan po nating umuwi sa bansang Pilipinas. Kung ang tanong is yung ibaban ba natin ang Pilipino pumunta ng Hong Kong, yun po yung ibig kong sabihin na wala po tayong ganyan klaseng decision, and it's really up to the Hong Kong government in terms of banning flights going to Hong Kong from the Philippines, no? Wala tayong dyan. Control dyan. But again, if for our OFWs who go to other countries, kabilang na ang Hong Kong, the best protection is yung pagbibigay natin ng full vaccination po sa kanila. But again, the policy remains. Sino mang Pilipino, saan man, sa mundo ay maaring umuwi sa Pilipinas. Wala pong ban against Filipinos coming home to the Philippines. All Filipinos who want to come home to the Philippines, welcome na welcome po.
Opo. Second question ni Joseph Morong for Conjen. Nasagot na po ni Conjen yung second question niya. Yung third question niya for Conjen pa rin po, what are we doing to help those who were terminated because they were positive? Would we know officially how many they are?
Yes, this really constitutes a very small number of, they're really a small minority, around 3 to 5. But we've gone around to talk to them, investigate the circumstances surrounding their case. At pero gaya po na sinasabi ko lagi, ang ating primary mission is to get them treated first, and then they receive medical attention. At pag gumaling po sila, we will revisit the situation, and we will ask them kung ano po talaga nangyari. At at kung mapatunayan nga po natin na they were asked to leave because of their sickness, ito po ay nasasabi po natin lagi na illegal, no? Illegal dismissal po ito under the Employment Ordinance of Hong Kong. Ngunit I'm glad to report din po that through the representations of the consulate and advice, many of those who were initially turned away by their employers are now actually back with their employers or went back to their boarding houses. So in a way, we are proactively, you know, engaging din yung mga employers to explain to them that terminating their employees at this difficult time, especially when they are sick, is not only illegal, it is immoral. So many of them have been convinced to take back their employees and to make sure that proper care and assistance is given to them.
Thank you, Conjen. From San Medinilla and Business Mirror, Secretary Karlo, what is the government daw po is doing to address the reported cases of bird flu in some farms in Central Luzon? How will the government ensure sufficiency of food supply as it addresses the spread of the said infection?
Yes, I think this pertains to the H5N1, highly pathogenic avian influenza, which the Department of Agriculture has confirmed in some farms in Baliwag, Bulacan, Candaba, and Mexico in Pampanga. So yung action response po ng inyong pamahalaan, immediate culling and proper disposal of all remaining birds in the affected farms, disease investigation, trace back and trace forward, surveillance in the 1 kilometer quarantine zone around the infected farms, and following established protocol, the Department of Agriculture has also informed the Department of Health para magkaroon ng coordinated action to be undertaken to avoid any risk of transmission to humans. The concerned LGUs have already been informed and onboarded sa next steps forward. The disease, according to DA and the BAI, remain isolated in ducks and quails in the two provinces. But nevertheless, the Bureau of Animal Industry is conducting massive surveillance on the 1 kilometer radius in the affected area. Our poultry stakeholders have been duly informed, and the Bureau of Animal Industry has advised and tasked them to self-monitor and conduct internal surveillance on their own farms. No test, no movement policy is now instituted in the affected provinces. And all queries regarding this event must be directed to your Department of Agriculture, Bureau of Animal Industry.
Apo, ang sunod pong tanong niya, na-discuss din po kaya ng cabinet officials with President Duterte ang expected impact ng Ukraine crisis sa local oil supply? If yes, may mga naging instruction po kaya si President Duterte to address the matter? Same, similar question po yan with Kylie Atienza ng Business World. Does the Ukraine crisis raise questions about the credibility of U.S. preparedness for Asian contingency, and how does the palace view the crisis?
Again, when I said that the president and your government is preparing for any and all eventualities and any and all contingencies are being prepared, kasama at kabilang sa kinakausap ni Pangulo yung mga kagawaran na directly involved at that will be directly involved for any and all eventualities and contingencies. No, kabilang na dyan ang Department of Transportation, kabilang na rin po dyan yung Department of Energy. And of course, our Security, Justice, and Peace Cluster.
Opo. From Sheena Torno ng SMNI News, may panawagan po ang ilang transport group na taasan hanggang 10 pesos ang pamasahe sa mga pampublikong transportasyon. Kasabay po ito ng patuloy na pagtaas ng langis. Ano po ang tugon ng Malacanang?
Ito po ay under na sa jurisdiction ng Department of Transportation at ng LTFRB. So pinag-aaralan din po yan lahat ng mga issues, hindi lamang po yan but all the other contingent issues that belong under the jurisdiction ng DOTR at LTFRB. So abangan na lang po natin kung ano yung magiging recommendation nila at magiging decision.
Opo. Ano daw po ang maibibigay na tulong ng gobyerno sa mga tsuper ngayong tumataas ang presyo ng langis?
Yes, again, that belongs under DOTR and LTFRB. No? But that being said, tulad ng nasabi ko na po nung last press briefing po natin, DOTR and LTFRB are ready to implement yung sinasabi nating fuel subsidy program under the General Appropriations Act or National Budget for 2022. Pero may mga conditions po kasi dyan eh. But as far as the preliminary list is concerned, nasubmit na po yan, yung mga paperwork, nasubmit na po yan sa DBM. And then there's just that issue about yung conditionalities bago po mag-take effect. At matrigger po yung provision na yan sa general appropriations law natin with regard to fuel subsidy. But your DOTR and LTFRB are ready to implement pag binigyan na po ng go signal.
From Ali Alvis, ng GMA News for Yusek Berhere. Yung first question po niya ay nasagot na ni Yusek Berhere. Second question, may inaasahan bang spike sa mga kaso dahil sa campaign activities?
Yes, Yusek Rakino. So, the probability is always there. Pero kumpiyansa po tayo ngayon that vaccines are working for us and hopefully maipatupad po natin na for all of those attending these campaign sorties, we can only have vaccinated individuals para lesser risk of transmission, lesser risk of infections, lesser risk of the probability of having spikes in the future.
Opo. Second question niya, Yusek Berhere, may updates po ba sa pag-aaral ng DOH sa Omicron sub lineage BA.2?
Yes, no. So, lay yung WHO nagbigay ng pahayag ng isang araw na base sa mga current evidences, ang BA.2 na sublineage ng Omicron ay mas transmissible. Pero sinabi rin nila, mas transmissible kesa sa BA.1. Pero sinabi rin nila, as to the severity of infections, wala pong pagkakaiba. There were no evidences to point that there are differences in severity between BA.1 and BA.2.
Thank you, Yusek Berhere. For Maricel Halili ng TV5, Sec Carlo and Yusek Berhere, Yusek Badoy criticized the Department of Health for allegedly defending a member of the Central Committee of the NPA. This is following the statement of DOH regarding the arrest of Dr. Maria Natividad Castro. The DOH has recognized the contribution of health workers, especially those who have opted to work with the underserved. Ano po ang masasabi ng Malacanang at ng DOH dito? Is this a fair statement?
Ang sinabi po ng Department of Health, no, and I quote, is that all our citizens, healthcare workers included, enjoy the constitutional guarantees of due process and presumption of innocence until proven guilty. We trust our authorities to uphold these rights, end of quote. So, hindi po salungat. Ang ating mga authorities, our legal authorities, the DILG, our law enforcement authorities, and all legal authorities maintain that lahat ng constitutional rights of the accused will be protected. And all protocols, legal protocols, and procedures were followed.
Opo. Second question po ni Maricel Lalili. Yusek Berhere, please. Go ahead, sorry.
Ano, we agree with CABSEC Nograles, Yusek Raki. Yun naman po ang naipalabas natin. Binigyan din lang po natin ng recognition. Ano? Ito pong ating mga doktor who are serving in the among the marginalized individuals or families in our country. But katulad po ng sabi ni CABSEC, kung ano po yung proseso, dyan naman po tayo, no? At tayo po ay naniniwala that the processes will be and the rights of the individual will be preserved and respected.
Thank you, Yusek Berhere. Sir Carlo, may follow-up lang po. Clarification si Joseph Morong.
Yes.
Ano daw po, no ban sa incoming passengers Filipinos or otherwise from Hong Kong?
Gaya ng sinabi ko, yung policy po natin, any Filipino from anywhere in the world who wants to come home, wala naman po tayong ban against Filipinos who want to come home. If the question is, meron bang ban ng Filipinos going to Hong Kong, that's up to the Hong Kong government. But wala ni naman din tayong ini-impose na ban. But they just have to follow the protocols and procedures as with any other country, di ba? Kung ano yung mga requirements para pumunta ka ng ibang jurisdiction or ibang territory or ibang country, sundin mo. At wala po tayong control dyan. That is, those are the policies and the rules and regulations of those territories, countries, or jurisdictions. But any Filipino who wants to come home to the Philippines, ang sabi ni Pangulo, payagan natin umuwi. Taga-Pilipinas, Pilipino yan, kababayan natin. So, Yan po yung policy. Never po nagbago yan.
Second question naman po ni Maricel Halili ng TV5. What are the chances that President Duterte will endorse Isko-Sara tandem?
Wala pong ini-endorse. Sabi ni Pangulo na he will not endorse any presidential candidate unless there is a justification or he sees the need to do so. But so far, up to now po, up to this point, ay wala po siyang ini-endorse. Gaya ng nasabi na po niya sa past Talk to the People address niya.
From Ace Romero ng Philippine Star, House Deputy Speaker Mikey Arroyo is urging President Duterte to call for a special session of Congress to allow lawmakers to act on pending bills that seek to reduce fuel prices. Is the President inclined to call for a special session? Why or why not?
Wala pong indication pa in terms of a pronouncement from the president to that effect, no? Again, you need the House of Representatives and the Senate together. Dapat mag-usap muna, no? Yung House of Representatives at Senate. And then, of course, mag-communicate kay Pangulong Duterte. But as of the moment, wala pa pong indication with regard to yung panawagan niyan.
From Tuesday nyo ng DCBB, Sec. Carlo, pinatawag daw po ng Malacanang si Dr. Ana Melissa Guerrero, Division Chief ng Pharmaceutical Division ng DOH, tungkol sa butika ng bayan. Ano po ang resulta ng meeting na ito?
I'll get back to you on that.
Okay. Thank you, Sec. Carlo. Thank you, Malacanang Press Corps at sa ating mga guests.
Maraming salamat, Yusek Rocky, at sa Malacanang Press Corps. Mga kababayan, as of February 20, 2022, nasa 33.5 million na individual ay qualified nang tumanggap ng booster shots ayon sa Department of Health. Ngunit nakakabahala na nasa 29% lamang ang nagpa-booster sa ating mga kababayan. Nasa mahigit 23 million pa ang walang booster shots. Iniisip siguro ng karamihan, bakit kailangan ito? Mababa naman na ang kaso ng COVID-19 sa bansa. There is very little risk of getting COVID today. Kuno, misguided po ang ganitong pananaw. Kailangan pa rin natin ng dagdag na proteksyon. Ika nga, it is better to be safe than sorry. Sabi nga ng Pangulo, pinag-aaralan nito ng mga eksperto, ang mga bakunang binibigay ng pamahalaan ay garantisadong dekalidad, ligtas at epektibo. Ito ay ating panlaban, hindi kalaban. Pangsagip ng buhay, pambangon ng kabuhayan, magpabakuna at magpa-booster shots na po tayo. Maraming salamat po and God bless.
Thank you, Secretary Karlo Nograles. Thank you po sa ating mga bisita at sa Malacanang Press Corps. Back to our main studio sa People's Television Network. Susunod na po ang Sentro Balita.